First Chronicles chapters 8 and 9. Chapter 8. Benjamin fathered Bela his firstborn, Ashbel the second, Ahira the third, Noha the fourth, and Rapha the fifth. And Bela had sons, Adar, Gera, Abihud, Abishua, Naaman, Ahoa, Gera, Shephufan, and Huram. These are the sons of Ehud. They were heads of fathers' houses of the inhabitants of Geba. And they were carried into exile to Menahath, Naaman, Ahijah, and Gera, that is, Eglam, who fathered Uzzah, and Ahihud. And Shearam fathered sons in the countries of Moab after he had sent away Husham and Bera, his wives. He fathered sons by Huldesh, his wife, Jobab, Zibiah, Misha, Malcolm, Jeuz, Zekiah, and Mirmah. These were his sons, heads of fathers' houses. He also fathered sons by Husham, Abitub, and Elpael. The sons of Elpael, Eber, Misham, and Shemet, who built Ono and Lod with its towns, and Beriah, and Shema. They were heads of fathers' houses of the inhabitants of Ajalon, who caused the inhabitants of Gath to flee, and Hahio, Sheshach, and Jeremoth, Zebediah, Arad, Eder, Machiel, Ishba, and Joha, were sons of Beriah. Zebediah, Meshullam, Izkai, Eber, Ishmariah, Izliah, and Jobad were the sons of Elpael, Jacob, Zichri, Zepti, Elianai, Zelophai, Eliel, Adiah, Bereah, and Shimrath were the sons of Shimei, Ishbin, Eber, Eliel, Abdin, Zichri, Hanan, Hananiah, Elam, and Thothijah, Iftiah, and Penuel are the sons of Shishak, Shemshirai, Sheerhira, Athaliah, Jerushiah, Elijah, and Zichri are the sons of Jeruhim. These were the heads of fathers' houses, according to their generations, chief men. These lived in Jerusalem. Jeiel, the father of Gibeon, lived in Gibeon, and the name of his wife was Maacah. His firstborn son, Abdon, then Zur, Kish, Baal, Nadab, Gedor, Ahio, Zeker, and Mikloth, he fathered Shimeah. Now these also lived opposite their kinsmen in Jerusalem, with their kinsmen. Ner was the father of Kish, Kish of Saul, Saul of Jonathan, Melchishua, Abinadab, and Eshbel, and the son of Jonathan was Meribbaal, and Meribbaal was the father of Micah. The sons of Micah, Python, Melek, Teriah, and Ahaz. Ahaz fathered Jehoada, and Jehoadad fathered Elameth, Asmaveth, and Zimri. Zimri fathered Moza. Moza fathered Biniah. Rapha was his son, and Asa his son, Azel his son. Azel has six sons, and these are the names, Azricam, Bokeru, Ishmael, Shariah, Obadiah, and Hanan. All these were sons of Azel. The sons of Ashek his brother, Ulam his firstborn, Jeush the second, and Alephalet the third. The sons of Ulam were men who were mighty warriors, bowmen, having many sons and grandsons, 150. All these were Benjaminites. Chapter 9. So all Israel was reported in genealogies, and these are written in the book of the kings of Israel. And Judah was taken into exile in Babylon because of their breach of faith. Now the first to dwell again in their possessions in their cities were Israel, the priests, the Levites, and the temple servants. And some of the people of Judah, Benjamin, Ephraim, and Manasseh, lived in Jerusalem. Uthai, the son of Ammihud, son of Omri, son of Imri, son of Bani, from the sons of Pirus, the sons of Judah. And of the Shalonites, Asaiah the firstborn, and his sons. Of the sons of Zerah, Jeuel, and their kinsmen, 690. Of the Benjaminites, Salo, the son of Meshullam, son of Mahodaviah, son of Hasanua, Ibaneah, the son of Jeroham, Elam, the son of Uzai, son of Mikrai, and Meshullam, the son of Shephatiah, son of Ruel, son of Ibnijah, and their kinsmen according to their generations, 956. All these were heads of fathers' houses according to their fathers' houses. Of the priests, Judea, Jehoiarib, Jachin, and Azariah, the son of Hilkiah, son of Meshullam, son of Zadok, son of Merioth, son of Ahitub, the chief officer of the house of God. And Adaiah, the son of Jerem, son of Pashur, son of Melchijah, and Maasai, the son of Adiel, son of Jazirah, son of Meshillah, son of Meshimeleth, son of Immer. Besides the kinsmen, heads of the fathers' houses, 1,760, mighty men for the work of the service of the house of God. Of the Levites, Shemaiah, son of Hashub, son of Azricam, son of Hashabiah, of the sons of Merari, and Bakbaker, Irash, Galal, and Metaniah, the son of Micah, son of Zikri, son of Asaph, and Obadiah, the son of Shemaiah, son of Galal, son of Deduthan, and Berechiah, the son of Asa, son of Elkanah, who lived in the villages of the Netophathites. The gatekeepers were Shalom, Achim, Talmon, Ahiman, and their kinsmen. Shalom was the chief. Until then, they were in the king's gate on the east side as the gatekeepers of the camps of the Levites. Shalom, the son of Korah, son of Abiasaph, son of Korah, and his kinsmen of his father's house, the Korahites, were in charge of the work of the service, keepers of the thresholds of the tent, as their fathers had been in charge of the camp of the Lord, keepers of the entrance. And Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, was the chief officer over them in time past, though the Lord was with him. Zechariah, the son of Meshlemiah, was gatekeeper at the entrance of the tent of meeting. All these who were chosen as gatekeepers at the thresholds were 212. They were enrolled by genealogies in their villages. David and Samuel, the seer, established them in their office of trust. So they and their sons were in charge of the gates of the house of the Lord, that is, the house of the tent, as guards. The gatekeepers were on the four sides, east, west, north, and south. And their kinsmen who were in their village were obligated to come in every 7 days, in turn, to be with these. But the four chief gatekeepers, who were Levites, were entrusted to be over the chambers and the treasures of the house of God. And they lodged around the house of God, for on them lay the duty of watching, and they had charge of opening it every morning. Some of them had charge of the utensils of service, for they were required to count them when they were brought in and taken out. Others of them were appointed over the furniture and over all the holy utensils, also over the fine flour, the wine, the oil, the incense, and the spices. Others of the sons of the priests prepare the mixing of the spices. And Mattathiah, one of the Levites, the firstborn of Shalom the Korahite, was entrusted with making the flat cakes. Also, some of the kinsmen of the Kohathites had charge of the showbread to prepare it every Sabbath. Now these, the singers, the heads of fathers' houses of the Levites, were in the chambers of the temple free from other service, for they were on duty day and night. These were heads of fathers' houses of the Levites, according to their generations, leaders. These lived in Jerusalem. In Gibeon lived the father of Gibeon, Jeiel, and the name of his wife was Maacah, and his firstborn son, Abdon, then Zur, Kish, Baal, Ner, Nadab, Gedor, Ahio, Zechariah, and Mikloth. And Mikloth was the father of Shemiam, and these also lived opposite their kinsmen in Jerusalem with their kinsmen. Ner fathered Kish, Kish fathered Saul, Saul fathered Jonathan, Malchishua, Abinadab, and Ishbael. And the son of Jonathan was Merib-Baal, and Merib-Baal fathered Micah. The sons of Micah, Python, Melech, Tiriah, and Ahaz. And Ahaz fathered Jerah, and Jerah fathered Elamath, Asmaveth, and Zimri. And Zimri fathered Moza. Moza fathered Benaiah, and Rephaiah was his son. Eliasa his son, Azel his son. Azel has 6 sons, and these are their names: Azricam, Bokuru, Ishmael, Shariah, Obadiah, and Hanan. These were the sons of Azel.
The following is the English translation of Pastor Molyneux's teaching on the book of 1 Chronicles, chapters 8 and 9, translated by Bryson. Read the Bible every day so you'll be full of faith. 1 Chronicles 8 is quite special because it details the genealogy of the tribe of Benjamin, and particularly notes that most members of this tribe lived in Jerusalem. It also records the genealogy of King Saul. You might wonder why the tribe of Benjamin is mentioned again in chapter 8, when it was already covered in chapter 7. Is it the case that Ezra, the author, forgot to include the tribe of Benjamin and is now reiterating it? Actually, that's not the case. The inclusion of Benjamin's genealogy at the end serves a divine purpose. The first tribe mentioned in the genealogies is Judah, and the last tribe mentioned is Benjamin. These two tribes represent the southern kingdom of Judah, which is under God's protection and oversight. This also signifies God's commitment to the covenant with David. So the tribe of Judah is recorded first, and the tribe of Benjamin is recorded last. The combination of these two tribes indicates God's intention. Ultimately, through the genealogy of Saul, the first king from the tribe of Benjamin, those returning to Jerusalem are reminded that kings are in God's hands, and he will watch over them. Saul, the first king of Israel from the tribe of Benjamin, was followed by David from the tribe of Judah. Thus, the selection and anointing of kings are in God's hands. Moreover, David's commitment to Jonathan's covenant ensures that God's promise to David will be fulfilled, with the tribe of Benjamin returning to Jerusalem. So, dear family, you can see how detailed and attentive God is. Throughout the scriptures, there are stories of women and accounts of pain recorded. In chapter 8, the final genealogy of Benjamin shows us something important. No matter how many storms and trials we've endured in the past, no matter how much pain we've endured, for example, being hurt, mistreated, or even abandoned, one thing you need to know is God wants to bring us back to His promises, His favor, and His grace. God is committed to taking care of us and fulfilling His promises. The fact that Benjamin's tribe is recorded last and even mentioned again emphasizes that God's eyes are always upon us. If we turn our hearts back to Him and ask for His help, His salvation, and His care, if we continually ask for His promises to be fulfilled in our lives, He will surely watch over us and preserve us. Even if we feel abandoned or overlooked by others, as long as we turn to God with sincerity, He will ensure His promises are fulfilled in our lives. In chapter 8, it begins by mentioning 5 of Benjamin's 10 sons. Why are only 5 of the 10 sons listed? Verse 8 notes that Saharim had 2 wives, Husham and Ba'ara, and that both women bore children, but both were later rejected by their husband. This detail might seem insignificant or unflattering, so why include this in the repeated genealogy of Benjamin? God wants us to understand something important, that He watches over Husham. The account of Husham's children, who were victorious and successful, is highlighted here. Husham had 5 sons, and these 5 sons achieved great victories in Moab and Gath. While Ephraim's descendants had previously been defeated in the Philistine cities, Benjamin's tribe, through Husham's son, show a different story. These 5 sons were dutiful, successful, and achieved great victories, illustrating God's care and blessing even in difficult circumstances. God wants to tell us something. Even if people abandon us, give up on us, or seem to despise us, no matter what we have done or how others treat us, God remembers us. He helps us and wants to bring us back to Jerusalem to start anew. So, dear family, we need to understand that there may be painful past experiences in our lives. Some brothers and sisters might have faced failures in marriages, in the workplace, or in relationships. You might have encountered unfair treatment in your family of origin, and this pain may still affect you. You may feel disappointed with your parents, your marriage, or even with yourself as you look back on your life. You might feel abandoned as if no one cares anymore. But don't give up. Judah and Benjamin are examples of this. Although one tribe is mentioned first and the other last, they had already been conquered by Babylon and Assyria. And, after 70 years, who's to remember them as Israelites? Their nation was gone, but when they remembered God's covenant and returned to Jerusalem, their genealogy was recorded to show that even though they had once been defeated and rejected, and they felt weak or were in pain, God would restore them doubly. You might think that these are just small matters in your life and wonder who cares, but I tell you, God cares. He will not allow His children to suffer unnecessary harm and pain. Today, if you have encountered pain and suffering, whether it's being abandoned in marriage, facing rejection in parent-child relationships, lacking trust or being falsely accused in the workplace, or feeling worthless and overlooked, dear family, know that God cares about you. The final record of Benjamin includes people who were once hurt. Husham, a woman who was not valued and was abandoned by her husband, God used her children to achieve victory and revival. Their names were recorded in the genealogy to show that God's intention is to restore and make us victorious again, despite past wounds. Verses 29 to 32 record the Benjamites living in Gibeon. Although the Benjamites were scattered in various places, a group residing in Gibeon was specifically noted. So in verses 29 to 32, what is Gibeon? Gibeon is a place of victory for Joshua. It is also a place where David achieved a great victory against Saul's army. Gibeon is also where God appeared to Solomon. When the returning people think of Gibeon, they remember that the Benjamites once lived there, a place of victory in God's care. Even though Husham, a woman, was abandoned, her five children achieved great victories in Gath and Moab. This reminds us that God has not forgotten us. The genealogy of Saul's descendants is meant to guide us to the selection of the king, starting in chapter 10. Even in the chaotic times of the judges, when priests like Eli were confused, God called Samuel, Saul, and eventually raised up David. So, don't be disappointed or discouraged. Even if you feel alone and overlooked, God cares. His hand is still in control and watching over you. As long as your heart continually returns to Him, He will replace past shame with glory, doubling the honor. He will bless your children, your career, and your mind. Ask God to remove shame and inferiority from your life, to take away the self-defeating thoughts and hurtful words that you constantly speak about yourself. In Jesus' name, let these completely leave you. You are called to be a mighty warrior, a victor, a king. This is the main reason why chapter 8 records the genealogy of Benjamin once again at the end. We are not failures. The people returning to Jerusalem are not exiles or pitiable. In God's eyes, they are mighty warriors and future kings. They are chosen by God. The past failures, abandonment, weakness, pain, and rejection can be overcome. God promises to care for, protect, and remember them. So, in chapter 9, you find a detailed list of the names of those who returned from exile. The records are meticulous, noting who returned and what they were to do, especially the Levites. The chapter details the Levites' service in the temple. But at that time, the temple was no longer standing. The Levites did not even know where they would serve. Returning to a desolate Jerusalem, they faced uncertainties about food, drink, and daily life. The priority seemed to be rebuilding homes and restoring land. But chapter 9 focuses on the Levites' role in temple worship and service. You might wonder, why God emphasizes temple service when the temple no longer exists? Shouldn't the focus be on rebuilding homes and farms? But God insists that the worship and service in the temple are so crucial. This highlights what God is focusing on. Sometimes in our lives, we might feel we have nothing. We might be experiencing immense pain in our marriage, or severe stress in our job, unsure of what the next step in life holds. And then we're told to worship, pray, read the Bible, and attend meetings. And then people just say that God will help us, and we might think it's just empty advice. Dear family, 1 Chronicles 9 is not empty advice. It tells us something crucial. For the returning people, the first step is to understand why they were previously exiled and why they lost God's blessings and grace. It was because they had lost their dedicated worship, their love for God, and their intimate relationship with Him. So, upon returning, the first priority is not to build houses, cultivate land, or arrange daily life. The first priority is to worship God, to arrange the service in the temple, and to return to the most important thing, worshiping God. This is not empty talk or an aiming too high suggestion. The chapter starts by noting that, and Judah was taken into exile in Babylon because of their breach of faith. Now the first to dwell again in their possessions in their cities were Israel, the priests, the Levites, and the temple servants. It emphasizes that they are returning to their own land and inheritance. Even though many years have passed, it is important to record the details of who returned. Israelites from the 12 tribes, priests, Levites, and temple servants, also known as Nephinim. Nephinim were originally Gibeonites who, after deceiving Joshua, agreed to serve in the temple, preparing water for purification, wood for the altar, and other necessary tasks. So those who returned were first identified as priests, Levites, and Nephinim. This tells us that God places great importance on whether their returning people first align with His covenant, meaning they need to know how to worship Him properly. When people find themselves with nothing and they're in dire straits and in great pain, they might think, I'll return to church, like the prodigal son. They've lost everything, marriage, career, and so on, and they come back to seek and love the Lord, hoping the church will help them, grant them grace, and give them a fresh start. Dear family, if you want a fresh start and a renewed life, begin by worshiping God properly. The first step should be to worship God rightly, serve God, and most of all, make God your first priority. If you get this step right and put God first, your subsequent concerns, your house, your career, your children, your marriage, will find resolution. The greatest fear is that after returning, you might become weak, falter, don't serve, or you fear your enemies. When we read Ezra, Nehemiah, and Esther, we see that God continues to gather his children. The first thing to do is to serve God. Those who first serve him will see their enemies driven away and their past losses restored. God will help you stand firm in your inheritance and establish a solid foundation. Starting in verse 3, the chapter introduces the returning Judahites, Benjamites, Ephraimites, and Manassites, detailing where their children settled and how many of them there were. It also describes the various roles of priests and Levites, including gatekeepers, caretakers, those in charge of the utensils of service, and worship leaders. This preparation highlights an important aspect of God's intention in verse 22. In verse 22, it is noted that these individuals were chosen. Dear family, if today we could serve God, worship him, and be assigned roles in the church, it is all part of God's glorious selection. You might be appointed a small group leader, a preacher, a church leader, or a shepherd in ministry. You might be a gatekeeper guarding the doors of the Lord's temple from all directions, north, south, east, and west. All of this is part of God's glorious choice. Even where we live, God will provide for us, including our roles and responsibilities, and even the resources mentioned here in the text. So, as we serve the church and our names appear on the list of ministry roles, we should be thankful. Our names are remembered and recorded by God. Even though the temple was not yet rebuilt and did not physically exist at the time, roles like gatekeepers, temple managers, worship leaders, and those managing temple equipment still needed to be organized. Service to God is not dependent on the physical presence of the temple. Instead, God continually guides us toward genuine service, reminding us that even without the physical temple, our service to him must remain sincere and committed. Dear family, even within the seemingly mundane genealogies recorded in Chronicles, there are secrets about how God turns defeat into victory. God comforts and encourages us to start anew, without discouragement or despair. In chapter 9, it may seem strange that there's an emphasis on the service in the temple, when the temple itself doesn't yet exist. What could be so important about preparing the incense, the garments, or the food offerings? It is important because God wants us to understand that the enemy seeks to steal, kill, and destroy our destined inheritance due to vulnerabilities in our life. One key vulnerability is not placing the service to God as the top priority. So, God reminds those who have returned from exile to prepare for service, even before the temple is built or functioning. It is about preparing the mindset and the roles for worship. Even though chapters 1 to 9 might seem dry and focused on genealogies and temple roles, they reveal God's intention. Why did he record each genealogy here? Each record is a reminder that we can turn defeat into victory. Our past failures are not our final outcome. Our ending is one of victory. Past shame does not define us. If we repent and confess, God will enable us to overcome and restore our inheritance. Why, upon returning, is the first priority not to build houses, cultivate lands, or establish defenses, but to focus on worship? It is to remind us that as long as we prioritize worship and service to God, align ourselves with his will, and offer a service suitable for him, God will address all the difficulties in our lives. From verses 35 to 40, the genealogy of Saul is recounted again to remind us how God previously chose King Saul and later chose David, a man after his own heart. In the future, God will raise up his son, the Messiah, to care for and help his people. So if you are willing to serve, your name will be recorded. The genealogies in chapter 9 include those who returned from exile. Some are priests, some are Levites, some Nephilim, and some are lesser known members of each tribe. To those living in Babylon, these returnees might have seemed to have made a mistake in returning to Jerusalem, but they were willing to pay the price to come back to the place of God's name. If everyone were unwilling to serve or participate in the work, many might think that serving in the church or in small roles doesn't matter and that no one cares. But I want to tell you, your name will be recorded. Even if you don't care about these genealogies or the names listed because you don't recognize them, God does. The service records in the church over the years might show the same few names repeatedly, which might seem unimportant to others, but they're significant to God. The genealogies in chapter 9 remind us that as long as we are willing to return to God and serve him wholeheartedly, making worship and honoring God our priority, our names are extremely precious in God's hands. So, dear family, as we finish reading the genealogies, we will move on to the history of the kings and First Chronicles. We will examine their successes and failures from a spiritual perspective. But through chapters 1 to 9, remember this. Even if we are ordinary people, if we love and serve God sincerely, our names are of great value in his eyes. Amen.
Dear Bible Race viewers and families in Christ, Thank you for watching our videos. We hope our sharing can enrich your life. If you find the content helpful, we hope you will support our ministry so we may continue to produce high-quality videos to serve the kingdom of God and hope to bless more people's lives. You can donate in the following ways: online giving by PayPal. If you are residing in Taiwan, you may also donate by bank transfer. Thanks again for your viewing and support. Every contribution is our greatest encouragement. We sincerely appreciate your support. May God bless you abundantly. Don't forget to subscribe, like, comment, and share.
Dear families, we hope that you enjoy the Bible race as much as we do. If you are willing to volunteer to translate the original Chinese teaching into English or assist with video editing, please email service@360sunrise.com. Thank you.